Hey internet friends, to give you the full understanding of how Haiti became ground zero for the present day global crime gang, we need to start at the beginning with a little accelerated history lesson. And fair warning, the history of Haiti is one brutal nightmare from beginning to end. Haiti is a country on the island of Hispaniola. One third of the island is Haiti, and the rest is the Dominican Republic. The juxtaposition between these two countries is stark, with one side marked by wealth and the other by poverty. The Dominican Republic being a product of Spanish colonialism, and Haiti, a country descended from slaves, brought over during the French colonial period. But all that changed in 1791 when the slaves revolted against their slave masters. But that's not where the story takes a happy turn. In fact, the Haiti we know today began as a war-torn country, a general public with no interest in returning to the plantations where they were formerly subjected to brutal enslavement, and a massive debt in reparations to be paid to their former slave masters. Side note y'all might find of interest on this debt is that Haiti's government was forced to finance that debt through loans from a single French bank, which capitalized on its monopoly by gouging Haiti with exorbitant interest rates and fees. Can y'all guess what family owned this bank? Sorry, let's get back to history. With an extensive period of unrest following Haiti's initial establishment, German businessmen had taken notice and they'd taken control of the economy by the early 1900s. And being on the brink of World War I, the US didn't like that. So after taking control of the central bank, the United States occupied Haiti and assumed control of the island, which led to bloodshed and depressions, followed by democratically elected presidents who didn't want to leave power, which led to dictators and a depleted economy, and then the AIDS epidemic. And then when Haiti finally caught a break, a terrible earthquake rattled Haiti, the aftermath being mass casualties, a wave of displaced persons, and a devastated country rife with chaos and confusion, creating the ideal grounds for corruption to flourish. Now, I know I'll get comments on this asking if the Haitian earthquake was a natural disaster or a coordinated attack courtesy of HAARP. But I'm not here to make a stance on that issue. I will say that there is evidence to suggest that weather modification and climatic warfare is a real thing. And in regards to the 2010 Haitian earthquake, there seems to be an element of foresight or prediction that lended itself to the benefit of criminals exploiting death and chaos. The country of Haiti does sit over two clashing tectonic plates, so the 2010 earthquake wasn't really a surprise to seismologists. But none of that matters for this video. What matters is that a devastating earthquake happened, and criminals exploited it, and they continue to. So who are the key players in the exploitation of Haiti? An already weak place with now defenseless people. And how did they manage to make a fortune off the tragedy of a country? Well, let us consider what resources Haiti has up for grabs after the earthquake. Oil, gold, minerals, children, and organs. And guess what? Haiti is not only a transoceanic shipping point for the Americas, but also for Africa and Europe as well. Convenient, huh? It's always the same players who desire these things because it's always the same syndicate of families willing to do anything to keep their power, wealth, and influence. For the elite minority to exploit the weak majority, specifically in the case of Haiti, corruption has to fester for a while, maybe for decades, through dictators and democracies and coups that seem organic but they're actually controlled, creating a foundation of filth on which to build a house of cards. That's where DynCorp comes in, the CIA's privatized covert services contractor, which, by the way, was created within the same year as the CIA. DynCorp has a sordid history of sex slavery, rape, and child abuse. And wherever they go, from Bosnia to Colombia, it doesn't matter. DynCorp is consistent. Since at least 1994, DynCorp has been actively engaged in military activities in Haiti, and they're still there today, training local police and United Nations police, among other things, I'm sure. But that's just one piece of the puzzle. These criminals have to fly under the radar by being disguised as nonprofits. So we have the Clinton Bush Haiti Fund, naturally, because Bush Sr., Daddy Bush, is Mr. CIA himself. And we also have the Clinton Foundation on the ground for relief efforts in Haiti after the earthquake, with Bill Clinton, the United Nations Special Envoy to the nation, and Hillary Clinton as Secretary of State, creating long-term development plans for the ravaged country. And then we have the Red Cross. The Red Cross received an outpouring of donations after the earthquake, nearly $500 million. The Red Cross says it has provided homes to more than 130,000 people, but the actual number of permanent homes the group has built in all of Haiti is 6. In fact, the number I'm coming across for the Clinton Foundation and the money missing from the Haitian relief efforts is to the tune of $2 billion. Where did all the money go? To answer this question, I think we have to look at where the vultures were circling after the earthquake. Certainly, some of the money went towards giving Hillary Clinton's brother a permit to this Haitian gold mine. Maybe some of it went toward bailing out Laura Silsby, who, along with the other members of New Life Children's Refuge, helped themselves to 33 Haitian children, most of whom were not even orphans. They said they were taking them to an orphanage they had yet to build and were caught smuggling these children over the Dominican Republic border without papers, which Huma Abedin was quite interested in as she forwarded emails of news articles covering this story repeatedly to Hillary Clinton. I think it's safe to say that some of that money went towards jet fuel for the Clintons to fly out to Haiti and bail out Laura Silsby.
Organ trafficking, yeah. Now
already.
Of the victims of the earthquake?
Yeah. So,
do you know that for sure?
Yeah, I know that for sure, and it was discussed in Montreal during the conference.
And do you know for sure that children are being trafficked now?
There is children trafficking for children and adult person also, because they need all type of organs. So,
no, but I mean live children, are they being trafficked now?
The report I received, yes.
Then again, maybe some of the money went towards various medical instruments for these doctors who were harvesting organs live on camera.
Well, you know what's interesting, Tony, is they don't need more supplies, they need the right supplies. So on the one hand, they don't have tourniquets, and they have 2 blood pressure cuffs for 200 patients. But on the other hand, here's what they do have. Corneas. Yes, these are actual corneas from cadavers that people lovingly donated, you know, signed their organ card. And they have corneas. They're not doing cornea surgery here.
Right.
They're barely able to do amputations. Yeah, so, I mean, no one knows how these ended up here. I found them underneath the table next to a box of granola bars.
And if you think organ harvesting is just a spooky story, a complete myth, think again. When there's hundreds of thousands of young people waiting on a kidney or heart transplant so they can have a shot at a full life, how else is an 80-something-year-old oil tycoon supposed to get a fresh heart to live another 30 minutes? Fun fact, people actually travel all over the world to Israel to get an organ transplant, which is interesting because Israeli Defense Forces medical team was praised for being some of the first doctors to help out in Haiti.
One unit has become legendary, the Israeli medical unit.
A liberal Democratic spokesperson in the House of Lords has just been sacked for accusing the Israeli troops of harvesting body parts in the aftermath of the earthquake. Israel admitted removing body parts during the autopsies in the 1990s without asking the relatives of the deceased as required by law, but denied every other.
I know I've probably skipped over a bunch of key players in the exploitation of Haiti, but I feel like I've given you the main ones. I didn't get to go into vaccine testing in Haiti, but you know, maybe you can do your own research and get there. George Webb's YouTube channel is a great place to start, and maybe we'll get closer to the truth uncovered by Monica Peterson, an assistant director at the Human Trafficking Center, who reportedly committed suicide in Haiti. There's a rumor going around from close friends and family that Monica Peterson was in Haiti investigating the Clinton Foundation, their gold mine, and the textile factory they run, and she was murdered because she got too close. But Washington Post, owned by Jeff Bezos, who recently secured a $600 million contract from the CIA, assured us that was all fake news. Either way, everyone knows something sinister is going down and has gone down in Haiti. So I look forward to your comments, and as always, have a wonderful day.